Central bank governorship is not an easy job in the best of times. And when one has to contend with an unheard of demonetization, set up an institution like the Monetary Policy Committee for the first time in a complex economy like India, manage a banking system that has accumulated over the years 10 trillion rupees of bad loans, and do all this in a highly uncertain global environment. Clearly, even surviving 2 years is an achievement. But how has Governor Urjit Patel fared in this very tough examination? And what are his challenges ahead? I have with me a panel of experts today to kind of grade the governor, may I say. Well, I have with me Behram Vakil, Managing Partner, AZB and Partners. I also have A.K. Bhattacharya, Senior Editor at the Business Standard. And in a bit, we are going to be joined by Ratan Roy, Director at the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy. He's also a part-time member of the Economic Advisory Council to the Prime Minister. Gentlemen, welcome. Thank you very much, Behram and AKB, for joining me. Let me come to you, AKB, first. Monetary policy, setting up the committee and navigating its first steps. How do you think Governor Patel has managed that?
Well, you know, before I answer this specific question of yours, let me say that to assess Urjit Patel is a difficult task because he unfortunately suffers a kind of an Amjad Khan syndrome in reverse. You know, Amjad Khan played his most brilliant role in Sholay, and whatever acting, whatever performances he had shown in other films, people had always referred to him as a Sholay man.
Okay.
And unfortunately for Dr. Patel, the demonetization thing was such that whatever wonderful things he has done in the remaining tenure of his three-year tenure, I sense that demonetization will always be talked about, and Urjit Patel will be identified with demonetization. So that's the unfortunate part. But on the Monetary Policy Committee thing, I think, and both inflation targeting as well as the Monetary Policy Committee thing, it was his committee that had recommended the entire structure of it. And I must say that right from the first policy that he undertook as the governor, he has stuck to the blueprint that was created by the government on the basis of the committee that he had headed. And so far, I would say that he has done quite well. His team has done quite well. The only thing I would say is probably we need some more disclosure on the minutes of the meeting in terms of how each and every member actually shared their views at those meetings. Right now, what we see is as a kind of a summary, but maybe at some point we would like to see the kind of the Fed Reserve kind of a minutes of the meeting, which are so detailed, and that will probably help in introducing greater transparency into the process.
Okay, I guess that's welcome advice which the government and the governor will take. You know, I'm also a veteran of covering, as a reporter, at least 100 policies. AKB, and I can tell you that what I found very distinct and very good in the Indian MPC tradition has been the tradition of naming each person with the comment he makes. It may have its downside because people may, you know, want to protect what they said before and be worried that this will be held against them. But it's a new institution. It's a new practice. Most other countries just give you the minutes and don't tell you who said what. So to that extent, I thought the governor has set up a brave new tradition. It's worked well so far. Let's see how history will pronounce upon it. But I personally think that's a contribution that India and Urjit Patel has made to monetary policy minutes. I'll come back to monetary policy making and to the currency as well, the core economics part. But I think we should not be looking at demonetization. We discussed it enough in the first year. In the second year, I think for me personally, the most brilliant career by any central banker is the contribution that Urjit Patel has made to the cleaning up of the banking system. Behram, you know, this is something you're personally involved in professionally as well. How would you rate the way in which this very tough task has been taken by the governor?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Latha. So, you know, I don't think I'm in a position to rate, but I can just say that it has been a fantastic experience. And I can't agree with you more. Right from day one, which was, if I remember right, the SR case in Gujarat, to the most recent decision in Allahabad, which was so crucial for IBC. As it goes forward, I personally never expected, of course, DG Vishwanathan and his team have been terrific and they are very hands-on. But I never expected to have the governor so hands-on and the communication to be so brisk and forthright. So he has been terrific from IBC standpoint. And, you know, as the last case, as I say, where the odds were heavily stacked against us with all the players, but extremely strong. And it was a fantastic experience.
I'll tell you what my fear was when the ordinance was passed and the act amended that RBI will give specific directions that specific cases be taken to the NCLT. My big fear was that cases could come against the RBI and the government using equality under the law clause, you know, Article 14. But the Reserve Bank's filters in terms of just saying the top 12 and, you know, so using absolutely neutral filters, do you think that has kind of won the day? And they have not been found wanting in terms of the fairness with which they have approached the cases. Behram, you first.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that it was well thought through. As you say, there were three perfect filters which have been challenged in court after court. And they have stood the test of time because they were extremely fair and had a good rationale behind them.
Your thoughts, AKB, on the cleanup process, first identifying people and sending and then the Feb 12 circular?
You know, the most admirable thing about the entire exercise is that he held the RBI and the RBI governor held their ground after every step they took, including the February 12, 2016, 2018 notification. I think the central bank firmly adhered to what it needed to be to do, and I think it did not really succumb to any pressure, whether discreet or direct or indirect, or even in the face of a court process where the government of India had given an affidavit for a special dispensation for the power sector. And I think the RBI stood its ground, and I think that's the admirable stance to have taken. And I think it will be a hold for the sector, for the economy in good stead for times to come.
No, you're absolutely right. And I don't know if that we can already say that that battle has been won. There is still a high-level committee which is going into the power assets. But clearly the governor and under his charge, the deputy governors have held their ground. You know, Behram, when the February circular first came, there was a lot of worry and perhaps concern on the part of the bankers that this one-day default may create mayhem. Now people tell me actually it's good because everybody reports on the day of default to the CRILC, and so we know, oh, this guy is a defaulter with that bank, and therefore the SMA1, SMA2 cases have also reduced. So people are not complaining so much about one-day default. Do you think all the heckles raised by the Feb 12 circular have been answered? Do you think now there will be fewer challenges to that circular?
I think so. I think so. Also, because, you know, the time, as you know, as the 6 months has run on the 28th. And I just want to reiterate, you know, exactly what was just said, that you can't have different rules for different sectors. If we had Allahabad had gone against RBI, you would have had a queue outside the door.
Yeah.
Rightfully so, in my personal opinion.
Mm.
So it was really crucial to stand so firm and so courageous against all odds.
Yep. To be fair, of course, the judiciary has also stood by the RBI, both Allahabad Court and the Supreme Court so far, though some might argue that it has stretched the timetable. Well, you know, we have to very quickly come to the currency issue as well. Your thoughts, AKB, do you think Governor's biggest challenge actually may be his third year? The currency and bond yields are proving to be a big challenge. What's your sense? Will he coast through? Because
yeah,
I mean, he's a rich man, $425 billion of reserves.
Yeah, but the question is whether that will be enough.
Mm.
You know, something that he achieved with great relative ease and little flourish is the manner in which the RBI, under his charge, redeemed the $26 billion FCNRB swap, you know. Now, in 2013, to counter the pressure on India's rupee, I think the RBI governor then had got into the $26 billion FCNRB swaps.
Yes, yes.
Now, they came up for redemption in 2016 in October, November.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, little thought is given to that, the manner in which those were redeemed.
Yes.
And the planning was done in advance by which the redemption happened without much trouble or disruption to the market. So I don't put it beyond Urjit Patel that he would also this time plan his actions in a way and his processes that the challenges, they are going to be formidable. Let us not make any mistake about it, because whether the trade war gets into a currency war and then there is a pressure on your currency, even $428 billion of reserves may not maybe a good defense to have,
but
we need to really walk the real tightrope, and he will need the government on his side here.
Oh yes, no two ways about that. But I guess the government will oblige, fiscal discipline perhaps, you know, the way in which they handle fuel prices. Well, what would you say is the biggest challenge ahead, Behram, for the third year?
Well, I, you know, the conversation you just had is above my pay grade. But so if I, the only addition to that is the number all of you know very well, is that I think in a way it's a little dangerous to keep giving the CAD in a percentage of GDP. It's 88 billion. That's a daunting figure. And that, you know, the BOP gap shouldn't slip too much. Otherwise, it'll get really dangerous. But I think I'll move back to IBC. I think the challenge is that we stay the course. The judiciary continues to give it the fantastic priority that it has given it, and the capacity building, because otherwise the NCLT and NCLAT, we can't have a choke at the top. So having just one appellate tribunal, I think very soon they're going to have to figure out a way to have a second and ideally a third. Same with the NCLTs, we should have ideally 20. They've just had three more. So I think these are the two big things. But otherwise, you know, I'm very proud to say that India is the spot for the distress funds, and if we maintain course, we will receive the capital that we need so crucially.
Okay. Well, gentlemen, I have to take a break and thank you. I like the way in which Behram says the question is above his pay grade. These doubts never come to journalists. So I'm going to go ahead and make as many editorial comments as I want to. But thank you very much, AKB and Behram, for joining us. We take a short break, and I hope by then Ratin Roy is ready to join us to give us his take on Urjit Patel's 2 years as RBI governor.